All right, part three of Azure Linux Policy Administration. And this part goes into working with Azure Linux. Azure Linux for subjects, so to speak. Now, in the first chapter, we basically explained that Azure Linux is in essence a mandatory access control system that is transparent to the system. That two processes on the system, that processes basically don't know what's going on. They know that Azure Linux, or they know that something is blocking access, or sometimes they don't even know it because they can't determine whether a system resource actually exists, because Azure Linux prevents them from determining that. But basically, they just don't know anything. They just know, okay, access is denied, I guess, and so I have to deal with that. But that's, so that's in essence, but that specified subjects can be allowed or can be expected to govern and be aware of aspects of Azure Linux. So that's also something we discussed previously, that programs, applications can be made Azure Linux aware. Just like users, user processes, shell processes can be Azure Linux aware. You can, for example, run the ID command and see what your current process context, what your current security context is. So you are aware that Azure Linux is enabled. And that's just because you are allowed to actually determine that. That's because Azure Linux allows you to determine your security context. Azure Linux gives you that freedom, to that discretion to determine whether in what security context you are operating. But in essence, Azure Linux is basically should be transparent. Nobody should ever, no process on the system should ever be bothered that Azure Linux is even there. It's none of their business. It's a mandatory access control system that is governed centrally, and processes on the system have generally no business thinking about Azure Linux, messing with Azure Linux. But there are buts and ifs. You can actually allow your programs to be aware of or actually be a part of Azure Linux, and that's evident by object managers, which we discussed, that you can actually implement a Azure Linux object manager in your application so that your application basically extends Azure Linux to the application layer. But anyways, so we really need to look at that that way. So by default, processes just don't know anything about, shouldn't know anything about Azure Linux, but there can be exceptions. That's the way you need to approach that. So if you as a policy administrator give some discretion to a process to determine something Azure Linux specific, or do something as Linux specific, or even something like that, then you need to be able, then you need to make sure that you educate and inform those subjects about how that discretion that Azure Linux provides affects them. And that's with regard to programs. Well, it should be obvious that if you use the Azure Linux libraries, that you should just know how those libraries work. But for example, if you have a computer system or a server, for example, a web server, where you want to basically allow your users to classify content, whether it's whether that's web server content or user generic user content, then you need to explain to the user, okay, these are your discretion, these are the things that you can do with regard to Azure Linux, and this is when you should do it, this is when you should not do it, this is how you should do it. Be clear about that. Always be clear about everything that a user can encounter with regard to SE Linux, because you need to, yeah, that's important, because if a user doesn't know exactly how to use something, then you, that basically facilitates mistakes, and mistakes are bad for security. So education and information is important, whether it is for application developers or for users on the system, it doesn't matter. They should just know what the hell they are doing, and what, yeah, what, if they can do anything with SE Linux, then what the hell they are doing to minimize chances of mistakes. So that's basically what this slide tells us. So working with SE Linux for users, subjects, I call it subjects because it also applies for unprivileged processes, not just users, not just shell processes, but also applications, user agents and stuff like that. So generally what subjects can do in a system is get status and modes. That's something that is usually not prevented by SE Linux. It can be prevented, but on most systems, users are, or subjects, processes are allowed to actually determine the status and the modes of apparatus of SE Linux. So we need to explain how that works and what that means, what a particular status or mode means, and stuff like that, so that they know what they're doing. So security policy may allow specified subjects to get the SE Linux status and modes. Now that's what I said. So let's just discuss some of the statuses. So you have statuses, either it's enabled or disabled. That's pretty obvious. And modes, there are two modes, enforcing or permissive. So let's just discuss these modes. The enforcing mode means that SE Linux is in host-based intrusion prevention mode. So it's actually actively preventing access that is not explicitly allowed by in policy. It prevents, and it actually logs the events that are prevented, that are the events that are not allowed. Permissive mode is actually host-based intrusion detection only mode. So rather than preventing intrusion, it just detects it and actually logs those events that are detected. So that's just one thing you should know. Enforcing, aka prevention mode, versus permissive, aka intrusion detection mode. So yeah, that's something that you should explain to your subjects, that permissive mode is detection only and enforcing mode is prevention. So the SE Linux enabled tool will return a access status of 0 if SE Linux is enabled, and will return an access status of 1 if SE Linux is disabled, or if it was enabled to determine the status. Because if the policy doesn't allow you to determine the status using the SE Linux enabled command, then it will just think it's disabled. So it will return disabled. So if you see, if the SE Linux command is actually available on a system and you run it and it returns disabled, then that doesn't necessarily mean that SE Linux is disabled. It could also mean that the user or the subject wasn't allowed to determine the status using that command. So the getEnforce tool will return enforcing, permissive or disabled if SE Linux is disabled or if it was enabled to determine the status. So enforcing if it's enforcing, permissive if it's permissive, or disabled if it's disabled, or if the process, the subject, wasn't allowed to determine the mode. SE status is the same stuff. If the user can run SE status, then it returns extensive information about the current status of SE Linux if the security policy permits that. If the user or the subject is allowed to determine the status using SE status. the is enabled function and the security get enforce function enable subjects to get status and mode information programmatic respectively if security policy permits. That's always the case. Just because you use a function in your application, that doesn't mean that the centralized security policy actually permits you to do that. So always, as an application program, always keep in mind that just because you run you call the function security get enforce and it returns disabled, that doesn't mean that SLinux is disabled. So don't write no code that assumes that SLinux is disabled if security get enforce returns is disabled, because that doesn't have to be the case. It just could be simply be the case that you weren't allowed to actually determine the status, and in that case SLinux is enabled. So be careful with that, and also just if you use those functions, just keep in mind that there's policy that actually governs whether you are allowed to do that. Just using a function doesn't mean that you are also allowed to do it. So SLinux for subjects get security context. So core utilities provide options that enable subjects to get security context of subjects and objects if security policy permits. So the same stuff is here. So here are some commands that users generally can use to retrieve security context generally, because you could actually create your policy in a way that it won't, these commands won't return the context. But anyway, so LSZ, capital Z, get security context of specified file objects. IDZ, get security context of current process. PSZ, get security context of all subjects with subjects user identity or group identity. Netstat, capital Z, get security context of subjects that connect to or listen on networks. And then there's some functions, the get filecon, getcon, get pitcon. Library functions allow specified subjects to get the security context of specified file objects, current subject, specified subjects programmatic respectively if the security policy permits that. Manually changing security identifiers. SIDs, security identifiers. So security policy may allow specified subjects processes to manually change select specified existing security identifiers or of file objects. Now, if that is the case, then educate and inform processes, subjects, users, or users about the meaning of SIDs that they can manually change. So if they have access to relabel a file to a particular SID and to relabel from a particular SID, then you need to explain what it means to change a particular SID and how you can change it and when he's expected to change it. Make sure that you are clear about the discretion that a process has when you give that him that discretion. So the TCON utility can be used to change specified existing security identifiers if the security policy permits. So it's important to note here that changes made with the TCON command or the TCON utility are not persistent. So a user might be able to use the TCON command to change a particular identifier to another particular identifier, but that change might not be persistent. It's only persistent if the system-wide security context specifications say that it's persistent. And else it's just not persistent and it will be temporarily until the sysadmin or the security admin decides to relabel the file system, and then everything will be reset to what is specified system-wide. So, specified existing security identifiers can be classified customizable types security identifiers by administrators. By adding the specified existing type security identifier to the list of customizable types located at /etc/linux/policy-module/context/customizable-type, where policy model is a variable for your particular policy model that is currently active. So anyways, so some types can be specified, can be classified customizable type by the administrator, or type security identifiers can be classified customizable type. And that basically means that, I'll get into that in the next paragraph. The restore con command can be used to reset security contexts of specified locations to the security context that is specified for that location system-wide by administrators or by security policy. The restore con utility will by default ignore security contexts that include customizable types, unless the restore con command or utility is used with the -F option or --force option. So here's the deal. Customized types that are classified customizable types will not be reset by default if you run restore con on a path that includes such type. And that's done for a particular reason. For example, you might want to give a unprivileged user discretion over a set of specified types used in user home directories. Well, if you give that user that discretion to actually change a type in a user home directory to another type, then obviously you can't specify on a system-wide level what a particular location in the user home directory should be labeled, because you don't know what a user decides to label it, because you gave that user the discretion to change the type of a particular set of locations. So yeah, you can't on a system-wide level determine what it should be, because you didn't determine that. But you can determine the basics, the defaults. So then you can basically make a set of specified security type identifiers customizable, and then restore con, which basically is a command that basically just reads the list of system-wide security contexts and then just commits them, will not reset any locations that include any types that are customizable. So it will just ignore them and don't reset them. So that's handy for types that you use, that you, yeah, that you give users discretion over to use. But that can be overridden if you use the force option. So if you use the force option with restore con, then it will reset it regardless of whether a type used is customizable or not. Now this is handy, for example, let's take one example. For example, the git session daemon. So you have a git daemon, and that can be actually run as an unprivileged user. And the git daemon actually reads a personal git repository, a git session daemon, reads a git personal repository, and then just hosts it so that others can basically clone it, I guess. But if you want to basically confine the git daemon, because it actually, the git session daemon actually listens on the port 9418, I guess, and if you allow the user to do that and the daemon to do that, then actually the git daemon is allowed, or is actually able, from a traditional Linux security perspective, to host, to serve any file in your home directory, I guess. So you want to specify that, you want to label your git repositories with a special git repository type, and then just allow the git daemon, the session daemon, to only read content with that type identifier. But then there's another question that begs to be asked is, okay, we have this type for repositories and user home directories, and we can actually specify a default location that's specified for Git repositories. But what if a user decides to use a custom location for his Git session repositories, personal repositories? What if he says, okay, I'll create a directory tilde slash blah, create a repository in there, and I want the Git daemon to serve that repository? Then you need to allow the user to actually change the label of the blah directory to use a type that Git can read, Git session daemon can read. So you need to give him the discretion to change from the generic user content type to the Git session content type. And then you need to make sure that you don't reset the labeling once you, if you are, for example, in need of restoring context in the user home directory. So you need to then make that type customizable so that you can be sure that you don't actually reset it to the default type, because then you'll break the user experience, because then all of a sudden Git session daemon cannot no longer read the repository, and the user comes complaining to you, okay, Git stopped working, and that's because you ran restore con on the home directory and it reset it to a type that Git can't read. So yeah, by making it customizable, you actually deal with issues like those. And to see the various customizable types, just look at the path here that I mentioned here. And if you want to add customizable types, then add them to the list, just so that you know when customizable types are used. It's usually only used for types that are used inside user home directories and that you want users to be able to change. So they need to be allowed to change from and to the types to be able to change them. Anyways, the setFileCon function allows specified subjects to change specified existing security identifiers of file objects programmatic if policy permits, as usual. Alright, so here's more. Security policy may allow specified subjects to manually change select specified existing security identifiers of subjects when a command is executed. So just like changing the identifiers of files, users may have discretion to actually change the security identifiers of processes that they run. If so, again, educate and inform subjects about the meaning of the SIDs that they can manually change. So with that said, the runcon utility can be used to execute commands with specified existing security identifiers if security policy permits. So you could give a user the discretion to run a application with a specified set of security identifiers if the policy permits. If you do so, explain to the user or to the program when to do so and how to do so. You don't want to make you don't want a user to make a mistake there and cause data loss or whatever, or cause problems. So always be careful. So I'm not going to I'm not going to get into the runcon command, but it's basically the same as gcon. I haven't actually talked about gcon that much either, but just use the manual page and try it out, and just keep in mind that you can only do this, you can only change context if the policy permits. So that's just one thing with you, because you can runcon. For example, I guess I could try it. Actually, I don't want to try it, but you could try to run something with a specific type, for example, runcon. Runcon. Let's just man runcon. Compute. So let's runcon c, and then type rpm t, And then, for example, ID, see, actually, failed to get security context of ID, no such file directory. Weird. Am I overlooking? Yeah, I don't use this command every day. No examples, no examples. Let's see if without C. Oh, actually, so this works. Actually, so now you can see that the run command actually allowed me to run the ID command with the RPM T type identifier. And that's what you see, because the ID command actually returns the context of the specified process. So yeah, this is allowed actually, because, well, the user is unconfined, so unrestricted. But yeah, so that's actually allowed. So if this, be careful, make sure that before you deploy stuff in production and you allow your users on your system, make sure you test, because users are smart asses sometimes, and they might figure out things about the policy that you are not aware of, and well, they might actually abuse that stuff. So always be smart. That's why I'm just going over this stuff, over these commands, because, well, I know people, some people are really smart and who would basically find ways to get out of their confinement. Anyways, so that's basically it. So the set execcon as Linux library function allows specified subjects to manually change specified existing security identifiers of subjects, processes, programmatic, when a command is executed, if the security policy permits. So again, in this case, the security policy permitted me to actually run the ID command with the RPMT type identifier. So, yeah. Anyways, on to more on manually changing security identifiers. So, if a specified user identity is associated with more than one specified existing role, sensitivity, or category security identifiers, then the subject with this user ID may be able to manually change specified existing role, sensitivity, category security identifiers if policy permits. So that's discussed in the previous sections as well, where we basically can create user identities, as Linux user identities, associate roles to them, and then use the policy language to actually allow a role to change, an existing role to change. And yeah, that can basically, that enables us to basically allow processes to change roles, and thus allows us to give processes access to one or more type identifier. If you allow users to change roles and thereby change security identifiers, then educate, inform your users about the security identifiers that they can manually change. Tell them how they can change it. Tell them what it means to change to a particular or from a particular security identifier. Be clear about it and make sure that you tell him what he can do and what he can't do, so that you just avoid issues. So login programs that use pluggable authentication modules, aka PAM, can enable specified subjects to specify a role, sensitivity, category, or range of the categories and sensitivities to use when they log into the system. The existing type security identifier associated with the specified existing role security identifier must have sufficient permissions to log in. So yeah, there's a difference, and we'll get into that later. If you allow a user to change role and thereby change type security identifier, then the user might try to use these roles and type security identifiers to log in. And you might want that, but yeah, the user must have the type must have the sufficient permissions to actually be able to log in. So some roles and some types can be used to log into the system, have the sufficient permissions to actually log into a system, where other types don't have the permissions. For example, some types might not have access to read the user home directory, and if you can't read the user home directory, then you can't log in, because bash can't read the bash config stuff, and you might not be able to create a sudo terminal and stuff like that. So that's why I'm just mentioning it, that it just depends on the permissions you have, whether you can or cannot actually use a role or n type to log in. The new role utility can be used to manually change specified existing role sensitivity category security identifiers. Alternately, specified existing type security identifiers that are associated with specified existing type role security identifiers can be manually changed if security policy permits. So the new basically what it says is if the policy permits, then users might be able to use the new role command to change their role and thereby their type security identifier. And same for sudo. Sudo utility can also be used to manually change specified existing role and ultimately type security identifiers. Well, but not sensitivity category security identifiers. So sudo allows you to change role and type, but not category and sensitivity. Not sure why. So on MLS systems or MCS systems, you might or might not want to allow the user to use new role to change manually, if you want to allow them to change manually. Whereas on systems that don't use MCS or MLS, you might be sufficed with sudo. Sudo is nicer because sudo is just nice in the sense that you can also use it to change the traditional identifiers like user ID and group ID, whereas new role only is only limited to SE Linux identifiers. Anyways, so sensitivity and category security identifiers can only be manually changed from secure terminals. So that's another thing. Sometimes you try a new role to change your sensitivity or something like that, and then it says can only be changed from secure terminals. And if that's happening, then you need to basically declare your terminal a secure terminal, specified can be classified secure terminals, type sits by administrator. So the type of this terminal can be declared a secure terminal by administrators by adding the specified existing type security identifier to the list of secure terminals located at, and then the path. But again, only used if you're using MLS, I guess, maybe MCS as well. I haven't actually tested that. All right, so working with SE Linux, but for SE Linux administrators. So now we discussed how users are affected. Let's discuss how SE Linux administrators work with SE Linux. So first, how administrators enable and disable SELinux, how they can enable and disable SELinux. So there are various ways. You can basically disable and enable SELinux using kernel options at build time. There's some options that you can use, config security SELinux to enable SELinux support, accepts yes or no. Config security disable SELinux is also runtime. Disable it on runtime, yes or no. But there's also some kernel boot parameters which allow you to that config security SELinux disable allows you to enable it and disable it or specify whether it's enabled or disabled on runtime, I guess. Kernel boot parameters, runtime, config security, SELinux boot param, so set the default, determine whether you want to allow want to use SELinux boot parameters, config security SELinux boot parameter value, so set the default value of the boot parameter. And then the various boot parameter values. So there's a boot parameter called SELinux, which allows you to set the status at runtime to either 0 or 1. And forcing allows you to set the mode at runtime to 0 or 1. SELinux config file is located at etc SELinux config, and there you can specify as well SELinux is either enforcing, permissive, or disabled. Prerequisites. So to enable SELinux, some prerequisites: config security, enable different security models, yes or no. Config default security, specify default optional security system at build time, so you can set that to SELinux if you want to set SELinux to be the default security system. I also discussed that in the first chapter. Config default security SELinux, enable SELinux default optional security system, so you can enable it by default, yes or no. Config ext4fs security, extended attribute supports for ext4 file system for the security extended attributes, yes or no. And that's build time, I guess. Yeah, that's build time. And the security set enforce and security disable SELinux library for functions enable subjects to change modes and disable SELinux programmatic if security policy permits. Alright. Permissive mode and permissive domains. So I already discussed permissive domains, permissive types with the SELinux policy language. Anyways, intrusion detection only mode, system wide, or for specified TE type security identifiers only. That's basically the difference between permissive mode and permissive domains. Either you run the system in permissive mode system-wide or just for a specified type security identifier. So permissive mode, physical access. If you have physical access, you can set it using the enforcing boot parameter with 1 or 0 to enforce or permissive mode. If security policy permits, you can also change SELinux option in the SELinux config to enforcing, permissive, and disabled if you have access to the file, I guess. The set enforce tool enables toggling between modes if you have permission to do that. You can use the set enforce tool to toggle between 1 and 0, permissive and enforcing. The security set enforce SELinux function enables toggling between modes on the fly programmatic if policy permits. manually add, list, remove permissive domains if security policy permits, as you manage permissive and then the command send add, delete, and then the TE type security identifier to make permissive, and you can list them as you manage permissive dash dash list to list all your permissive types, permissive domains. And what it does, it simply creates, builds, and loads a loadable policy module with the name type TE type security identifier underscore permissive, and then TE type security identifier, and that's a basically a variable for the actual type security identifier with the TE permissive type statement. So here's an example. So you declare a policy module. Now we already discussed how you do that. Module name, module version. Then you require the type identifier that you want to use to that you want to make permissive, because well, it already exists, so you need to require it, import it, and then you use the permissive statement to make that type identifier permissive. Managing system security context specifications. So system security context specifications can be defined manually by administrators with the SE manage utility, or defined in security policy. So system security context specifications located under etc SE Linux, and then that path files in that path used to inform SE Linux and applications that must be aware of SE Linux or enforce access control decisions using SE Linux about applicable security contexts or individual security identifiers. Local system security context specifications are stored in files with the period local suffix, so in that location described above. Exception: port object security context specifications defined manually by administrators with the SE manage tool are stored in etc local policy model modules active ports period local. System security context specifications for subjects located under blah 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 located under that location. Files with system security context specification substitutions for file objects have the period sub suffix or period sub dist suffix if the system security context specification substitutions are specific to the current distribution. Administrators are encouraged to not edit the files located under etc SE Linux policy model context files. If you do, then edit files with local suffix only and use the SE module tool with the build option to commit the changes, but just don't do it. Basically. So the restore utility can be used to apply or commit existing file object system security context specifications to locations. So common restore utility options are dash capital R to restore context recursively, and the dash V to be verbose. So another thing to note is that the restore utility does not follow symbolic links by default. So what the restore basically does, it just reads the list of system-wide security context specifications and restores path accordingly, resets context accordingly. So here we go a little bit deeper into list, add, delete, modify file object system security context specifications using the SE manage tool. So SE manage F context dash dash list to list all existing file object system security context specifications. Exception: does not list existing file object system security context specifications that apply to all user home directories. So yeah, user home directories are treated differently, and that's basically also due to the fact that we need to take into account the identities of the users. So you can actually determine system-wide whether a user is has the identity of Joe identity or Jane identity, because yeah, that's specified using the user declaration, the user statement. So, and that's up to the administrator. So you can't actually treat all the home directories the same, because some might have the one identity identifier and other might have another identity identifier. And if you actually enforce policy based on identity identifiers, then you want that to be correct, because else if labeling is not correct, then the enforcement cannot be correct. So that's why user home directories are treated differently, and also with regard to categories and sensitivities, you can't actually determine or specify on a generic level what sensitivity or security level a particular home there should have. And that's why we're using a different way to deal with home directories, rather than specifying how we specify it for other locations. But we'll discuss that. Anyways, here's some options to add security contacts. As managed have contacts, add, delete, modify, no reload, so don't reload the policy. And then you can specify as a user, aka the identity, role, type, range, security contacts, identifiers, and then location. And you can use regular expressions, by the way. So if you want to learn a little bit about POSIX regular expressions, if you want to make add exotic file context specifications system wide. The F-type option enables administrators to optionally specify the file object class to which the file object system security context specification should apply. So, and I described that also in the first chapter, that the first bit of the permission bits basically show you what kind of object you're dealing with. And basically, as Linux allows you to use those identifiers, I guess, to specify whether you want a security context to apply to just a directory or to a file or to everything or to a sock or to a character file or to a link file, block file, socket file, pipe, stuff like that. So the F-type option allows you to specify that. The location can optionally be defined using POSIX regular expression, so I described that. The MatchPathCon utility enables administrators to verify whether a defined file context file object system security context specification matches a specified path. So if you added a file context specification system wide, then use the match path command with the location to see if it actually, if SE Linux actually interprets it right. And that's handy if you use regular expressions, just to see that your regular expression actually catches the location that you mean to catch with it. So due to the nature of the user home directories, file object system security context specifications for file objects in all user home directories are specified in the security policy only. So there you go. So if you want to change security context specifications that apply to all user home directories, then you need to do that using policy modules only, unfortunately. To add file object system security context specifications for specified file objects in all user home directories, loadable policy modules and the home underscore dir keyword can be used. So here's an example of how you would do that. So if you have a, for example, you want to have the period my search directory in user home directories, in all user home directories, be labeled with the type home search T, then you'd do it like this. You declare a policy module, my home dir fc specs, for example, a name, just an example. And then you require the type that you want to use. And then you create a file context file. And then you specify your file context like this. You use the home dir keyword. And then the path using regular expressions in this case, and escape the dots in directories with the slash backslash, and then the file context that you want to use But the home dir is basically keyword is basically expanded using the compilation tools to the proper context, because the identities will have to be changed, and we also have to deal with security levels and stuff like that. So this is basically the way. Try it out a little bit. Not going to get into the details. Anyways, you use the check module command like I demonstrated here to basically create a module, a binary module, and then use the SE module package command to actually create a policy package out of the binary module and the file context file. And then you use the SE module command to actually load the policy package into the system. And then you can basically use the match path con to actually test whether the file context applies, and use restore con with the options that you'd like to actually apply the file context to the locations, and then after that check whether everything is committed properly using the lsdz path command. Warning: due to the nature of world writable locations like temp and dev shem, it is encouraged to not define file object system security context specifications for file objects using under those locations. This applies especially if administrators use the MLS or the MCS security model to control the flow of information in shared computer systems. SE Linux could reset security level security attributes and consequently declassify information. So don't specify file context specifications for locations under temp or dev shem or any other world writable location. Instead, labeling of file objects under these locations should be defined in security policy using file object transition rules only instead. And we discussed file object transition rules in the previous chapter, so you should know by now from a high level how to do that. Making file object system security context specification substitution managing. The SE manage tool enables administrators to substitute file object system security context specifications for whole directory hierarchies using the equal option substitute. So that's handy. For example, if you have and I'll probably show you an example. Common scenario is relocation of the user home root directory. So here's an example: SE manage f context and then add or delete or modify and then equal and then the original location and the location to substitute. So if you want to basically move your slash home directory to, for example, slash users, then you can basically use the SE manage f context command with the equal option to basically substitute a whole hierarchy of contexts in one go instead of manually adding all these contexts, which is impossible because of the nature of the home directory, which is should be treated differently. But this allows you to do that. So that's a neat feature. The file object system security context specification substitutions cannot be nested. Okay, and there's an if. So if you decide to basically use substitute home with users, then you cannot substitute under users after that. So if you later decide, okay, I'm going to substitute, for example, var under users, then that won't work, because then you'll nest substitutions. That won't work. So be careful. If you use substitutions, be careful. Just keep in mind, okay, I can only substitute once below this location. So be aware of that. Managing port object system security context specifications. So the SE manage tool enables administrators to manually change existing network port object system sensitivity category and type security identifiers. And here's an example: SE manage port list to list all the existing object port object system security context specifications. This is wrong. It's not file its port object. As you manage port, add, delete, modify, range type, option, security identifier, protocol, port or port range, and then some examples here. This adds a port type identifier, my port type T, to ports with this range, but only this protocol TCP. And then list it to verify that you did it right. And then port object system security context specifications cannot be defined using loadable policy modules. So that sucks. You can actually use loadable policy modules to declare port types, port type identifiers, security identifiers, but you can't actually use these modules to actually create port context specifications like you would, for example, for file context specifications in the FC file, which I demonstrated earlier with the home directory stuff. But you can't do that with port context specifications, so you have to do that manually. That sucks, but it's just the way it is. Poof, okay. Still managing system security context specifications. The role-based, identity-based, and optionally MLS or MCS access control security models enable administrators to optionally allow users to manually change role type and optionally sensitivity and category security identifiers by associating role sensitivity and category security identifiers to identity security identifiers. Okay, we already knew that, but anyways, that I already explained that. Role security identifiers are additionally associated to the type security identifiers. Identity security identifiers are associated to user identity and group identity. We already explained that. Login programs and utilities that enable users to manually change either role type sensitivity or category security identifiers should be made aware of default and possible combinations. So yeah, you need to actually tell login programs what security context they should use by default. If you give users access to various security contexts, then the login program needs to know what to use by default. And you also should probably no combinations, although that's not mandatory, because sometimes you can specify that. But if you can't specify that, then you need to actually specify combinations that are possible. For example, role type, security level combinations. Anyways, files located under etc as a Linux context, and I forgot to add the policy model here, for context users correlate to existing identity security identifiers. So for an user underscore u identity, you would have a file in this location called users underscore u, and that correlates to each other. The files enable administrators to specify default and possible combinations of role and type, and optionally sensitivity and category security identifiers, and optionally associate these to the security identifiers of login programs and utilities that enable them to determine default and possible combinations of security identifiers for users. What a line, what a sentence. If a login program cannot determine a default combination of role type and optionally sensitivity and category security identifiers, it will ask the user for a role security identifier to log in, for the user to log in or fill. The new role and sudo utilities enable users to additionally manually specify combinations of security identifiers on the command line. And of course, all this stuff only works if policy permits. So I don't have an example of that, but we'll definitely use these default contexts later. So you'll see later how that fits in. All right, managing Boolean flags. Booleans enable administrators to manually insert or remove specified existing conditional security policy on the fly. The SCManage toggle SCBool, get SCBool, and set SCBool tools enable administrators to list and change Boolean flags.
Boolean flags can be manually changed temporarily in memory or persistently on disk. Examples: to view the status of a and a brief human readable description of a specified Boolean identifier, as you manage Boolean list and then grab Boolean identifier. To change the flag of two specified Boolean identifiers to true persistently in a single transaction. So this is handy because sometimes you have to change like a couple of Booleans, and if you do them separately then it takes a long time because you do it persistent on disk, so that it needs to recompile the policy. But if you do it in a single transaction like in this example, then it just needs to build it one time and it saves you a lot of time. So the security get Boolean active, security get Boolean name, security get Boolean pending, security set Boolean, and security set Boolean list. As a linked library functions, enable subjects to get set Boolean flags programmatic if security policy permits. And the same goes, of course, for the manage for the other commands. It's always if policy permits. All right, managing loadable policy modules. So loadable policy modules enable administrators to easily extend security policy and modify parts of the security policy. The SE module tool enables administrators to list, install, remove, enable, disable specified optional security policy modules. And then there's an example, SE module list modules, install, remove, enable, disable policy packages. By disabling a security policy module rather than removing it, administrators prevent security policy updates from attempting to reinstall it, the disabled policy module. This is also handy to know that if you want to get rid of some policy module, then it's usually best to just disable it rather than removing it, because if you remove it and later you basically update your policy package from the upstream repository, then it just reinstalls it, whereas if you disable it, then the policy package or the RPM or whatever will notice that it's disabled and will not try to reinstall it. The SE module tool additionally enables administrators to build security policy and to build security policy with don't audit TEAV rules, access factor rules removed from security policy. So in practice, this functionality is commonly used by administrators to diagnose security policy flaws. So yeah, the as Linux may be instructed to silently prevent specified events by mistake. So yeah, that sometimes happens, where the policy author decided to silently deny some event, and then later it turns out that he did so by mistake, but it may have affected some other stuff. So usually, if you do policy development, it's usually a good idea to just load the policy without the don't audit rules, because that will enable you to see everything that is denied, whether it's silently denied or not. And then there are some examples of the procedure of how you do that. So you'll basically build with the don't audit rules, then you reproduce the event, and then you use the outsearch command or whatever to see check the AFC denials, which also include the ones that would normally be hidden, and then you can undo the SE module build, disable the don't audit by just running SE module build. That'll basically reinsert the don't audit rules, and this is a common procedure, unfortunately, because yeah, I always say use don't audit rules, be conservative with don't audit rules, don't audit stuff for the sake of don't auditing. Anyways, managing users and logins.
So the SEManage tool enables administrators to list and manually manage identity security identifiers and to associate or dissociate specified existing role security identifiers and optionally specified existing sensitivity and category security identifiers to or from identity security identifier. Jesus Christ. This is a prerequisite if administrators want to allow specified users to be able to manually change or automatically transition specified existing role and optionally sensitivity and category security identifiers. So, yeah, it's another prerequisite to use SEManage to declare users as user identities. But yeah, you need to associate the various identifiers to the user identity if you want the user identity to be able to use it. So here are some examples. SEManage user list, add, delete, modify, level, security level, range, roles, prefixes, which prefixes are no longer used, so you can ignore that or set that to user. And then you can specify the identity security identifier to create, to decline. Examples, list identity security identifiers, SEManage user list, declare identity security identifier and associate role security identifiers. So that's basically the same as that user statement for the IBAC, get the IBAC user statement where you say user and then the identifier to create and then roles and then the roles to assign to the user. Managing logins. So actually, so far we didn't actually create associate to traditional Linux security. Actually, the logins associate to actual traditional Linux security. So the SEManage tool enables administrators to list and manually manage associations of specified existing identity security identifiers to specified existing Linux user and group identities, and to optionally associate or disassociate specified existing sensitivity and category security identifiers to or from specified existing Linux user and group identities. Optional specified existing sensitivity and category security identifiers associated to specified existing Linux user or group identifiers must be a subset of the optional specified existing sensitivity and category identifiers that were assigned to the identity security identifier associated to the specified existing Linux user or group identities. Okay. Wow. Yeah. It's true, but it's, yeah. It sounds complex, but it is the truth. But yeah. Basically, if your user association, your identity is not associated to a category that you use when you create a login association between your identity and a user Linux user identity, then that won't work because the identity identifier must have access to the category if you want to be able to use it. So it must be a subset of the categories or sensitivities that you associated to your identity. This is a prerequisite if administrators want to allow specified users to be able to manually change or automatically transition specified existing role and optional sensitivity category. So yeah, you must actually associate categories and sensitivities to Linux user identities if you want them to be able to manually change or automatically transition. Okay, and that's a small example here. Oh yeah, here basically the percent sign with group basically
You can basically use that to assign a S Linux user identity identifier to groups rather than just user identities. Examples: lists, existing login associations, associating existing identity security identifier and existing range subset with user as a manage login add as a user identity security identifier and then the range and then the range subset and then the user. Okay, and this last one, phew, managing logins. So the user add utility can optionally be used to associate Linux user identities with specified existing identity security identifiers. So user add with capital Z and then the identity security identifier and then user ID, and that'll automatically associate the user to the identity security identifier. And the SE manage tool enables administrators to define a default association of specified existing identity security identifier. Oh yeah, and optionally specified existing range subset with newly created users. So if you want to basically create a login association that applies to all users by default, well, there's probably already one in place, but if you could change it, for example, then you use the SMNS login, and then instead of add, you would use modify, and then you specify the SE user that you want to, the identity security identifier that you by default want to associate to, especially to any users, and a default range that you want to associate to by default to users. So yeah, I could show it, but I'm not root right now, so I can't. All right. But anyways, that's it. So yeah, I basically skimmed over a lot of stuff, which is very unfortunate because it's just a lot of trash. But a lot of this will later on be actually used in practically, so that might enable you to actually put the bits and pieces together, I guess.